I'm Graeme Martin. Thanks for getting out of bed so early on a Sunday and coming into this little lecture. It's nice to see so many smiling faces. So I'm going to talk about food and about the future of food. In particular, at the end anyway, I'll get to what we at UWA are doing about it. But I need to go through some fairly major issues first. One is that agriculture has problems. Okay, so basically, what we've been doing for the last 10,000 years has been fine for the last 10,000 years, but right now, it's no longer fine. So we have landscape degradation. And we have these sorts of things happening in our landscapes in places where we would normally grow food. And I love this photo because you see the little horses down here. So, and when you see these sorts of things, which are really disastrous in agricultural terms, what you see is effectively a loss of soil. And soil takes millions of years to make, and so when you lose it, you don't get it back. It's all over. It's a one-way gate. And so really, any practices that cause loss of soil are a problem. Then we have the issue of biodiversity loss. So this is a photograph of Western Australia taken by a NASA astronaut. So here you can see Rottnest. So this is obviously Perth down here to the Capes. Out here would be Esperance. And this is the Wheat Belt. And you can see what it looks like. It used to look like this and this, and now it looks like this. This is the biggest single event in human history of land use change. All of this happened in only roughly 100 years. And it's never happened before anywhere on the planet at that rate. So as a consequence, you can see why the native plants and animals of, for example, Western Australia are in trouble. So the number of threatened species, this is an Australia-wide map, and so 1 to 9 threatened species is green, and orange is horrible. Okay, you can see that out here where you've got massive development, there's some serious numbers. And we, in the Wheat Belt area, are in this range here, 50 to 100 odd species under threat. And I think you'd have to agree with me, right, that Australia without its animals is no longer Australia. Then we have issues like greenhouse gas emissions. So this is Australia's greenhouse gas emissions in agriculture. It's about 17% of our CO2 equivalents. I put up here land use change and forestry because I think they probably go mostly together. And I've got a black box here, which I will show you what is behind the black box later on. But agriculture is not innocent in this game. We have emissions in agriculture, carbon emissions. About 2/3 of this comes from livestock. Then we have the GM controversy, the genetically modified foods controversy. And it was dealt with in the courts in Western Australia with this horrible story about two once upon a time friends who became mortal enemies almost and fought it out in the courts. So this gives us overall then a perception, right, that basically agriculture is destructive and that farmers are destroyers. Now I'm here today to reverse that perception. Right. Also, as a consequence of this, we have a city-country divide, okay? The economic importance of agriculture is smaller than it was when I was a child, for example. My father was a farmer. And in those days, agriculture was the major export industry. Now, with mining boom, we have a change of perception. Even after the mining boom, mining is still really big. In addition, food is now abundant and cheap. When I was born in the 1950s, it was after the Second World War, and people were sick to death of food queues and food coupons all around the world. And so there was a massive investment in agriculture, and as a consequence now, food is abundant and cheap for people like us. There are now also fewer personal connections between the city and the country. Again, when I grew up, everybody had relatives with farms, and we used to go and stay on farms or go and stay in the city and swap places. And so people became familiar with the landscape and with farming. I've met lots of people in Perth, young people in Perth, who've never been east of the Darling Scarp, except in an aeroplane. So there's been a regional population decline, partly because farms are getting bigger and consolidating. And then we are a nation of urban people, and we have therefore urban politics. And there's also an even worse disconnection, which is a disconnection with the origins of food. This story came out yesterday. 7% of Americans think chocolate milk comes from brown cows. It's easy to laugh at the Americans, isn't it? I don't know what the data are for Australia, but I'm worried. Okay? So the disconnection of the origins of food is a serious issue, and all of these things add up to the farming community, rural communities and farmers themselves having lost their political clout. Okay? They don't have the say they used to have in the way the world is operating. Right. So here's a question. Some of you may be farmers. Any farmers in the audience? No, not even any retired farmers. Okay, it's a question for you then. Why are you not a farmer? Why are you not a farmer? Well, you are not a farmer because farmers exist. They provide your food. Otherwise, you'd be a farmer. Right. So this is my list of reality checks for the leafy suburbs. The leafy suburbs of Perth. Yeah, western suburbs, of course. In Sydney, it would be eastern suburbs. But the leafy suburbs. Reality check number one. 10,000 years of agriculture has transformed us from a hunter-gatherer society into a modern civilization. Without agriculture, that would never have happened. We wouldn't be sitting in here nursing our iPhones without agriculture. Number two, Australia's greenhouse gas emissions. This is the first part of the graph I showed you. Okay? The question is, what's behind the black box? Behind the black box, we have waste, transport, roughly the same size as agriculture, as you can see, and industrial processes. Most people think industry itself is a big generator, but it's not really. And then we have a big gap down here. What's down here? Well, this one here is obvious, stationary energy. This is one of the sort of euphemisms they use for burning coal to make electricity. Okay, we have a lot of these funny words we use to talk about the story. There's still a gap in here, though. This one's called fugitive emissions. What's fugitive emissions? When I first saw this data, I didn't have a clue. I had to go and find out. It turns out to be emissions primarily of methane, but also carbon dioxide, that come out of mines when you dig up coal or oil. And of course, these industries don't like to be blamed for this, so they separate it off into a thing called fugitive emissions that nobody understands. So my view is the reality is that these things actually go together. And so in the end then, stationary energy is worth almost 60% of our total emissions, easily dwarfing agriculture. Remembering that agriculture produces food as well as exports, and a lot of stationary energy is about lifestyle. Right, reality check number three, food. So this is food for 2 weeks for a normal family in Norway and food for 2 weeks for a normal family in Chad. 11% of income, 51% of income. In other countries around the world, like Malawi and some parts of India, it's probably more like 90%. So when I say we are eating cheap food, I'm right. It costs you almost nothing to buy your food. It's not a major part of your spending pattern. You probably spend more on your mobile phone than you spend on food. So, we are living in an era for countries like our own where food is very, very cheap. Right. 50 years of the cheapest food in human history, but it's now going to come to an end. Reality check number three. Why? You can sort of guess this graphic, the years here up to roughly present, and billions of people. So human population has been creeping along, and then in recent times, it's changed dramatically, the population growth. And if you're a demographer, the specialist people who study these sorts of phenomena, you can make projections from this. And one projection is that it will level off sooner or later at about 20 billion people. But in actual fact, these days, the best data from around the world says it's better than that, which is really a great relief, isn't it? It's probably going to level off at between 10 and 12. So the question is, of course, what will cause the levelling off? We all hope it's nice things, not bad things, okay? And it probably is nice things. It's probably about income, particularly for women, and independence and education for women around the world. So a lot of women in this audience, you should be pushing for education for women for the sake of humanity. In fact, it doesn't matter which one of these projections you follow, roughly in 2050, there'll be something like 9 or 10 billion people. I don't know where you'll be in 2050. I'll probably be dead. That's life, okay? I'll be 99 years old, if I'm still alive. Most of you I see in the audience, though, will be right hammering with midlife and going for it, okay? Having a great time, doing things, looking after children, having careers, going on holidays. This is your future, 2050. With 50% more people on the planet. Right. Even worse is we waste food. I hope you haven't been ignoring the food waste campaign on television, on ABC. A third of all food produced on the planet is wasted. A third. 60% of that is avoidable. A lot of it's caused by bad storage, particularly in developing countries. But for us, the excuses are pathetic. The leafy suburbs, Australia, $25 billion per year is wasted on food that we buy and then throw away. In Western Australia, 2 million tonnes per year of food goes into landfill. I don't know how you see this is anything but a disgrace. Right. On top of this problem of us throwing away food and our population increasing, farmland is diminishing. Part of it's about the erosion I talked about early on. Part of it's about urban spread over good farmland. But there's more. So I'm going to show you some data here. Arable land, hectares per person. This is a world average numbers. And what we have is a little band down here that says the number of hectares you need to feed one person for a year. It's about 0.2, 0.23 hectares with the current technology. These are worldwide averages, okay? And I'm going to show you some data. 1950, 2000, so this is historical data. Then 2050, which is a prediction. Well, let's look at Australia. In 1950, we were well above the green line. We're a big country with not many people in 1950, and we're still a big country with not many people, so we're still above the line, and in fact, since then, we've opened up more land for agriculture. The prediction for 2050 is we're going to come back to roughly the 1950 number. Again, we'll still be a big country with not many people, and we're a food-exporting country. Here's Canada, very similar to us, big country, not many people, but you see they're heading downwards a bit scarily. And the interesting one is this one. So the USA used to be comfortable and now it's a net food importer, and that will continue. Okay, what about the other countries in the world? So here's our, I'm going to have to look at all of these. I can't look at every country, obviously, but I'm going to pick out a few. And here's us here, the one we've just seen. But I need to change this scale here because I need to expand so we can see what happens down here. So let's just do that. We change the scale and then we see what happens. There's our countries. Now, what happens to the rest of the world? What is your prediction here? Where do you think these little graphs are going to go? Look along there for your favourite country. And you'll see the problem we've got out here is the total world picture. So in 1950, we were roughly okay. But now, we're heading into a bit of a disaster area. And this makes it even worse that we waste food. Meanwhile, there's a billion people starving and a billion people eating too much. Again, a really disgraceful situation. So the question is, can we just continue on to 2050 with business as usual? Surely you know what I'm going to say. It's simply not going to be good enough, is it? Okay? We cannot continue this way and expect to be okay. Right. The next question is, who do we expect to feed and clothe the world without destroying the planet? The farmers. Right. Let's look at a little bit of problem here, okay? Let's what's confronting the farmers right now in Western Australia. First of all, climate change. So this is a scenario with medium emissions, forecast to 2030, temperature increase and rainfall decrease. And here's our wheat belt area. So you can see it's going to be a bit of an increase by 2030 and roughly 5 or 10% decrease in rainfall. We farm dry land, so any decrease in rainfall just makes life even more difficult than it already is. If we take these predictions further into the future, you can see that out here, 2070, it's looking awfully grim with a couple of degrees extra and really between 10 and 20% loss of rainfall with medium emissions forecast. Farmers are going through tough business conditions. So here is the reality done in data. Terms of trade, which is how profitable they can be, from 1950 out to roughly now. Here is the prices they pay for their goods. These are all normalised to modern dollars, okay? So you can see roughly the prices they pay haven't changed very much for all of the things they need to make their farm work. On the other hand, the prices they receive for their production has declined massively. And the difference between how much you pay and how much you receive, of course, is your profit. And this is a really big challenge, and it's one of the major driving forces behind the consolidation of farms into bigger and bigger farms. You'll notice this little spike here? That's when I was born. So I was born at the top of prices received, which allowed my father to give me a very good education. Right, on a positive note about our farmers are really good at their job. I mean, seriously, they are amongst the best in the world. How do we judge that? This one measure of judge, all right? Top technology adopters, they adopt technology faster than almost anybody. They farm the worst soils in the world with a highly variable rainfall pattern, and they still stay afloat. Here's a measure of their efficiency, water use efficiency, okay? Again, 1980 out to roughly 2015. You can see that they've become more and more efficient at the use of water over those two or three decades. Other parts of the country have struggled. This is the eastern states of Australia. So we've outdone the eastern states as well, despite having by far the worst soils. They're not protected by subsidies. Most Australians don't understand this. United States, Europe, there's subsidies everywhere in agriculture to keep farmers in business, to reduce the cost of their inputs. We don't have that. And yet, we manage to feed 25 million Australians and 40 million other people around the world in Australia. And Western Australia is the biggest grain exporter of Australia. So they're doing a good job, aren't they? What are we doing in this space? Well, we've created this project called UWA Future Farm 2050. In this project, the university bought a farm, and then we are trying to imagine the ideal farm for Western Australia's wheat belt for 2050. That's in many ways an academic exercise, hopefully data-driven as much as we can be. And it takes a bit of bravery to imagine 2050, quite frankly, and academics are not very brave people. So it's taken us a while. And then what we're going to do, and we've started already, is we're going to transform the university's farm into that ideal model. And while we're doing that, make money. There's no point in us setting up an absolutely spectacularly wonderful, beautiful, perfect farm if no one else will follow our model. And so profit is a major driver in our decision making. A big constraint, in fact. So everything we want to do to change the farm goes against this test. So the farm is called Ridgefield. It's out here in the wheat belt. It's not really central wheat belt, but it's a couple of hours from Perth. This is a map or an aerial photograph. This Nectar Boyajian Nature Reserve, okay, which is a 12,000 hectare state-owned reserve, which is really good for us because it's a sort of gold standard of what the environment was like before Europeans came along. You can notice the colour of the photograph here, and you can notice out here there's not a lot of bush left on the farm. Here is the outline of the farm. So we've got some small areas. These are rocky outcrops, actually, granite outcrops, which couldn't be farmed anyway. But the rest is pretty much 100% over to agriculture. 1,600 hectares and 425 millimetres of rain per year. Perth has about 800, 900 millimetres per year, except maybe this year. So as we go to Pingelly, we get down to half of that and a bit less reliability. And this year, in fact, so far, we're looking at the worst year in 50 years. Right, at four enterprises. I use this word enterprise to describe our activities on the farm because I want people to remember that we have to be thinking about profitability. So the first enterprise we call ecological cropping, and I'll explain these a little bit more in a second. The second we call CGE livestock. The third we call ecosystem and biodiversity, and the fourth one is about people. It's about thriving farmers in vibrant communities. Right, first thing is the soil. I've already told you how important soil is. So Matthias Leopold in our group, he looks after soil in this fashion. He sees it as a critical zone from the top of the trees right down to the bedrock. And he studies the flow of nutrients and water in this system to better understand the whole system rather than just the surface 10 centimetres where we grow stuff. We have a critical zone observatory, the only one in the Southern Hemisphere, the first and the only one. And around the world, there's a network of these observatories. And they love ours because it's so different. As I said, the worst soils in the world and a very dry climate. So it makes us different to all of the other observatories. Ecological cropping, okay? Our mantra here is to make every raindrop count. We don't irrigate, we can't irrigate, it's impossible. We're completely dependent on rain. So we have to maximise the value we get out of every drop that falls on the ground. And we're heading towards a drier and hotter climate, so it's becoming even more imperative. We have no tillage, so we don't turn the soil before we put a crop in. Okay? The seeds and the fertiliser go straight into the soil, often through last year's crop. This allows us to conserve soil water, soil carbon and soil structure. And of course, we have zero tolerance for erosion. And one of the problems with having a policy of zero tolerance is you can't always make it happen. This year is going to be difficult. You know, any windstorm that comes along now is just going to blow our soil away because it's so dry. And then, of course, we have weed and pest management. This in itself is a major issue in modern agriculture because we've traditionally managed weeds by using herbicides, and now the herbicides are becoming less and less useful because the weeds are resistant. And without herbicides, this is not possible, so this is not possible. So you can see here, this is a very vexing issue. Right, precision agriculture is the name of the game. Our tractor is equipped with GPS. This is not our tractor. It's equipped with GPS, okay? The whole farm is mapped to 4 centimetre squares by GPS. So you can take your hands off the steering wheel of the tractor and it will plough the field, not plough the field, sow the crop in the field, turn around and come back and put each time 4 centimetres away from where the previous one was. We have yield maps. With engineering faculty here and private companies, Ausplough and Jacobs, we're developing new ideas in sensors for soil, water and nutrients, in data communications, and in the future we imagine our big, big machines being replaced by swarm robots. This is really exciting and fun. It's like lots of toys for boys, right? So it's really quite cool. But even so, right now, this is what we're doing. And we're not alone, everybody else is doing that as well. Okay, enterprise number two is CGE, livestock. What is CGE? Well, CGE comes out of the basic observation that our societies are changing with respect to their attitudes to animal products. Okay, if our societies are changing, that means our markets are changing. So we have new market forces. And the key words here are clean and green and ethical, hence CGE. Clean means less hormones and drugs, so we try to reduce that load on the animals. Green means ecosystem care, taking care of the ecosystem, and ethics means animal welfare. And you'd have to be hiding under a rock not to think that these three things are really important in the development of livestock industries these days. Basically then, these three words have now become aspects of product quality. So we used to buy milk and meat and things on the basis of taste, other aspects of food quality and human health, of course, bacterial contamination. Now people are asking, but how was the food produced? And in particular, in our export markets, which are high-priced markets, these are critical questions because people in those markets have discretionary spending power. They can decide which one to buy. They're not desperate to buy any food at all. They can make a choice, and they can afford to pay more. And this explains the whole organic food movement. So these three words are the future of our livestock industry, so therefore they're built into the Future Farm project. Let me give you, I can't go through this whole slide here. I could spend a whole day on this slide just about. Let's just talk about the green for a second because it reminisces a bit from what I said before. Methane. Methane is a greenhouse gas, 23 or 25 times stronger than CO2. Okay. We have discovered one of Australia's native plants, Eremophila glabra. Some of you may have it in your gardens. Okay. That sheep will eat. And when they do, it reduces their methane emissions. And this is typical of the story of Australian agriculture. When we were colonised by the British, okay, they came here, looked at all the Australian native animals and said, rubbish. Looked at all Australian native plants and said, can't use them. We'll bring everything from England. And they did. So that's what we have. And now, a couple of hundred years later, with the benefit of hindsight, we're realising there are a few mistakes in there, and this is one of them, not realising the value of some of these plants. These two guys here, Phil Virko and Dean Revell, won the Prime Minister's Prize for Science in 2013 for what I'm going to show you on the next slide. So this is Eremophila on the university farm in a small plantation where we were growing it for experimental purposes. What are the advantages of Eremophila? Reducing methane emissions, I've already mentioned. It's a perennial. So this photograph was taken in the autumn, and you can see out here there's not a lot of green, okay? The grass is dead, yellow or grey, which means it's almost impossible even for sheep to digest it. Eremophila, it's green. It's a perennial. It's drought resistant. It doesn't even notice droughts. We all panic when we get down to 200 millimetres of rainfall per year. Eremophila just carries on because it evolved in our environment. It has good biomass that produces enough food here for animals to eat. It also is self-medicating. In other words, when the animals eat it, it helps the animals to fight the worms in its stomach. We all have worms. You've got worms. I've got worms, right? They have worms, and we've been controlling the worms with drugs since about the 1950s. And now, damn it, the worms are resistant to the drugs. Just the same way as we have antibiotic resistance in our hospitals, okay? We're losing the power of this powerful chemical. And yet here we have a plant that can help us do the job. It provides shelter during lambing. So here's a female sheep, and she's hiding her lambs behind this bush, and it keeps them out of the wind and the rain. They're born in the winter, and if we're not careful, they will die of cold. And this helps. It's reduced our lamb mortality down to almost zero. It's deep-rooted. So it helps us to control the water table and therefore salinity. And finally, biodiversity. It's a native Australian plant. And where these things are in the middle of the landscape, there are birds aplenty. They love it. So what a magic bush this is. And Phil Virko and Dean Revell have discovered maybe four or five others that are just as good. And now we're looking all around the world to find more such opportunities. Okay, so ecosystem restoration is about plant biodiversity and animal biodiversity. So this is one of the hills in our farm. You can see lots of xantharias in here. And what we've done here is this part, we've selected this part for an ecosystem restoration study. Basically, the soil here is very thin, there's bedrock below it, and this site also connects this bush to a river down the valley. So it's an ideal place to put a corridor for wildlife. So in August 2010, we dug it up like this and we put in 12,000 plants of 14 different species. We're looking at the impact on profit and we're looking at a thing called carbon farming. Okay, so here we are 6 months later. And I need to tell you that 2010 is the worst rainfall year in 100 years of records on the farm. We had 225 millimetres of rain instead of 425. And we were wondering if they would survive. 95% survival. Why is that? Well, because they didn't even notice the drought. These are the species that evolved in this particular landscape. They just thought it was normal. 12 months later, looked like this. This is 2011. Now they're all higher than the ceiling here. And we're looking at how much carbon they can store. So ecosystem restoration is actually really easy. Right. So what we're doing now, this Boyajin Reserve, you've got a creek line along here. We're sort of thinking about green bands through that connect up the remnants that we have. Unfortunately, we don't own this land in here. One day, maybe we will. So we put livestock in here because here is not very good for cropping. And here we have a concentration of crop production and here as well. Okay, my fourth and final enterprise is people. Industry pressures we handle with technical solutions. So we do a lot of scientific research and technical development for crops and livestock and ecosystem. That's what we do at universities. Excuse me. Societal pressures are different. So societal pressures are the things from society, the pressures from society that the farming community is getting and feeling every day. It's their experience of the city's reactions to what they do. Okay? And it is actually a serious issue. Mental health issues, depression, and suicide are really big in farming communities. And this led to Sue Bailey, my colleague, developing a concept she calls eco-social work. So what is eco-social work? Basically, eco-social work combines work on social systems and ecological systems. So we scientists do the ecological system, she does the social system, and she brings the two together, making this one of the most multidisciplinary studies you can possibly imagine. Agriculture is already massively multidisciplinary. And she brings in the people sides. And she uses what she calls a loss and grief model, okay? Farming communities have a loss. They've lost their land, sometimes they've lost their heritage, they've lost familiarity with their life work, they've lost security in terms of income, and they feel like they've massively lost respect from the leafy suburbs. And yet they also think that they created civilization. The grief is partly denial, and it leads to lack of action, so they're resistant to change, and this is a part of the problem, right? But it's a necessary part of the final solution, right? You've got to go through grief before you can manage the future. So that's what she does. She looks at it from this perspective, okay? So basically, going through loss and grief is understanding and facing reality. It's the first step forward. Right. So what she does then is that she sets up programs to support resilience, okay? Help the people who are already quite resilient to stay resilient, okay? And she calls this asset-based community development. So she looks at what they've got, what are their strengths, and then she helps them to develop it further in this context of going into the future. building relationships, focus on what is strong, not what is wrong, building relationships with community leaders, with Indigenous elders, with us, the universities, and with the business community. So she consolidates all of the strengths of these communities and then helps them to realise that they are strong and resilient people and then form a plan to move forward. So just before I finish up, I'm just going to point out that we are not alone. The UWA Future Farm was the first Future Farm project in the world. And now we have colleagues in other countries. First on board after us was in fact India. This is in Kerala, where a university farm has been dedicated to the Future Farm concept. We have one in Malawi. They don't have farms in Malawi, they're too poor. A farmer with one goat in Malawi is a rich man. And so they have cooperatives. This is Uruguay, where INEA, the state government research organisation, has dedicated one of their farms to the concept. This is Rothamsted Research in the UK, who have a farm in Devon, which is dedicated to the concept. This is Massey University in New Zealand, where they've dedicated one of their six dairy farms, mind you, six. One of their dairy farms, which is right next to the river near Hamilton, they've dedicated that to the Future Farm concept. China, we don't have a farm yet, but we're negotiating. And up here, well, we're still trying to figure out what to do, as is the whole world. Right, let me just talk about Kerala for a second. Kerala is wet tropics. The farm is in the mountains. It's in a spectacularly beautiful place called Silent Valley. It's actually called Tiruvuzumkunnu. Silent Valley is my translation because that's too hard to say. So, and here, they've done exactly the same thing. They don't have sheep and canola, okay? They have buffaloes for milk, they have goats for meat, they produce peppercorns, they produce cashew nuts, they produce coconuts, geese, and they have an aquaculture system in a lake in the middle of the farm. It's so different, remarkably different, and a completely different socioeconomic environment. But when we get together, we have the same questions. We ask the same questions. The answers are different, the responses are different, the implementation is different, but we have the same questions. So I'm going to leave it there, and if you want to ask me some questions, you can. I've spoken a bit too long, I think. And if you ask questions, I'm supposed to give you the microphone so it's recorded. Does anybody want to ask a question? Yes. Hang on.
Okay, so my question is that mainly related to the livestock, is it really possible to have an ethical livestock production system and also faced with the greenhouse gas emissions that they produce and, you know, issues with land degradation and, you know, especially in when we need to feed more people, the inefficiency of converting, you know, vegetable matter to meat then to eat the meat, should we be looking at maybe moving towards a system of plant-based diets and, you know, developing, you know, even the, you know, meat-free meat and things like that, you know, given how, I think it was E.O. Wilson, he estimated that if we, you know, move to a plant-based diet, we could feed 4 million more people, no, 4 billion more people in the world.
Thank you. And a very, very good question, isn't it? Okay. And it's a question lots of people around the world are asking. And I actually have another lecture I can give on this topic because I think the answer is that we need to do both. Okay. So first of all, let's talk about greenhouse gases. Okay. We can dismiss that one quite easily. Between management, genetics and changing food for the animals, we can probably reduce that to negligible compared to motor cars in the next 10 years. So I think that won't be an issue any longer. The issue of landscape degradation is a problem where there are too many animals on the land. You're right. Okay? So that's part of what has to be managed. And then there's the issue of food production. Okay? So what we do right now is we grow a lot of human food that we then feed to animals. Okay? So we take cows, dairy cows, for example, right, and we put them in a pen. Instead of letting them eat the grass that they evolved to eat over millions of years, and we feed them soya and corn and things like this instead of feeding those things to humans. So we can produce milk and meat that we can then feed to humans, and this is the inefficiency. So you're dead right, okay? I can imagine over the next 10 or 15 years a lot of pressure coming onto those systems to stop that from happening. You know, what we should do is have the cows eating the grass in the fields where we can't grow crops because it's too rocky or too mountainous, and then we eat the meat and milk, okay? I'm not vegetarian, I'm carnivorous, but so I think that's part of the essential part of the solution there, is being sensible about landscape use. Ethics. So all livestock industries are confronted with ethical issues, okay, in the modern world, in our modern world, okay? If you're in Indonesia, it's less of a problem. If you're in China, it's less of a problem. And there are lots of people in China. So one of the risks with ethics is transferring your ethical platform to some other culture, okay, which is a really difficult thing to do, as we've seen with our live export industries, okay? It doesn't mean we should stop. So what have we done, for example, at University Farm, okay? We've stopped mulesing. Mulesing is one of the most controversial parts of sheep management in Australia. It's where they remove the skin around the tail to stop fly strike. We don't do it. We stopped 4 years ago, which forces us to find better ways to manage fly strike. And we're doing that. Okay? In fact, we can manage fly strike virtually all completely tomorrow simply by breeding animals that are resistant to fly strike. We've proved that it can work over 15 years. And I don't know why all farmers don't do it. So that's our campaign in that side. So I can't answer your question forever and ever and ever here because there are other questions, but I can attempt to jump out a few bits of it.
Graeme, thank you very much for the talk. It was very interesting. My question to you is, how do you take your learnings from the Ridgeway Farm to the farming community so that you get genuine change? And how do we lobby to get farmers better supported in our own communities so that they're not facing incredibly small margins and effectively creating, well, they're delivering an industry but they can't sustain their own lifestyles?
Wow, that's three big questions, I think, actually. Okay, let's start with the outreach one. We have an outreach program, okay? We have university parlance, KPIs, okay? So key performance indicators with press releases, with stories. We have direct outreach programs where we take people to the farm. We have industry groups there and so on. We are only one place and we don't have a massive budget for this. So we effectively therefore outreach, we outreach to schools, okay, but let's get away from it a second. We outreach to the farming community through the higher levels, through the Department of Agriculture, CSIRO, the consultants and so on, okay? And I can see you wrinkle your face at the Department of Agriculture. But I think that's changing. So we have to go at that level so we can talk to one person, so train the trainer, okay, about the thinking of the whole thing. Clearly, we talk a lot about this in our agriculture degrees at the University of Western Australia. We take high school kids out there. We had a program that stopped because of funding but was really successful for a few years called City Kids to the Country, where high school students in their courses would go to the greenhouse and plant trees, or grow trees from seed, and then we would take them out for a day and they would plant in our ecosystem restoration areas. And in some parts of the farm, that activity simply transformed the landscape. It's been brilliant. And I see that as social engineering via children. Okay, it's a matter of educating people about how to think about these things. Right, the other ones you're talking about were far heavier and deeper policy issues. Agriculture has struggled politically in the last 20 years primarily because of the focus on mining. And it's struggled not only in terms of political interest but also in terms of its workforce. People have been taken from agriculture to the mines. So farmers didn't have labourers. Okay? And so that was a really critical difficulty. And hence we had backpackers and Irish people and so forth all helping out. That's changing. Okay, we're getting back to a more balanced view of, I think, our economy and the world. And with that change, I hope, therefore, there will be a change in political will. I'm not a political person, but I actually am quite refreshed by seeing some pretty difficult questions being asked by the current Minister for Agriculture in Western Australia about what we should be doing for the future. And I just hope she has the political power to make things happen. As for changing profitability, we can interfere artificially with subsidies and things, but I actually think that's a downward step. I think that, you know, that would just... We would lose our position, our little platform that we stand on when we say no subsidies. And I think we will never get a logical, unbiased production system unless we remove subsidies. So in the United States, corn farmers are given a subsidy to grow corn to give to the ethanol distillers to make ethanol to run cars. The ethanol distillers are given a subsidy to make ethanol to make, you know. So the whole thing is completely artificial, okay? And it's using human food. It's the stupidest thing you can possibly imagine. So I think subsidies are just really a dangerous pathway, and I'm pretty happy we didn't do it.
Okay, I will try to find my words, but I think that my question was also a little bit related policies, because when you were talking about like this model, at least my idea is was that you were talking about like small community farms. I'm from Argentina, and in my country, like the farmers are a little bit different system. It's more monopolized. Like the owners of the lands are sometimes they don't even have connection with the lands, and it's a little more difficult idea for people to get like compromise with change and those ideas only because they love their land more. I think that we really need like public policies or ways of controlling good practice. And my question is like, once you find a better way of doing farm things, do you think that there are also ways of trying to move that towards way of controlling good and bad practices? And if in your models, do you have like indicators of good or bad practices, or where is that you can kind of like control or implement this in a way that it's not only depending on the goodwill of the people that own the lands, but more a thing that's going to be like a must. I don't know if I...
Don't worry about your English, it's a good... Okay, so this is actually a really interesting issue, right? Because in fact, the Argentinian system is a risk for us. We are seeing a lot of consolidation of small farms into big farms, and we're seeing a lot of external purchases of small farms. I was speaking to some Chinese people here just a few days ago, and they have just bought 500,000 hectares in the Kimberley, and they're investing $200 million. Now, you think, wow, everything with China is big, okay? So they just do things big. So we're worried, I guess, about this, what we call consolidation, okay? And we're seeing it within Australia as well. Australians are buying it. Mining companies are buying farms. So we're getting corporatisation of farms rather than going away from the private family farms. So the critical words you said there are love of the land. And I think that's a major value in local farmers who own their own farms, okay? They really do love the place. They know it really well. They can tell when things are wrong. And they look after every square metre, not approximately 85% of the square metres, because that's what we can do in our corporation. So I think there are a lot of attractions to that model, which is why the people side of our project is so important. We want happy farmers, thriving farmers in vibrant communities, because then they become strong. The Institute of Agriculture is having a industry forum here in about 2 months, I think, on consolidation of farms. So I suggest you go to that and listen to the conversation, okay? Talk to me afterwards if you want to get some more details, yeah.
Hello, I'm the person you mentioned from China, and my English is not very good as well. And my question is, because if you think about the projection of 2050, that population in the global world is like increased up by, I guess, 70 billion? 7 billion or 8 billion? Okay. So I'm thinking, comparing to the supply side, for demand side, not only because of the population drives up the price, but also other of the factors that may maybe drive up the price, because keeping the price stability is a really important issue. So what do you think about any attributes of how to control the price?
How long have we got to go? Last question, right. Okay, last question is from China. I go to China every year to teach, and I love what happens there and what they do, but they've got big problems with landscape degradation because of agriculture, and they've got a very big population. So it's a very vexing question for the Chinese people. What can we do to control prices? Well, I actually like to have free market here, okay? I think the market should control the prices, and therefore demand will control the prices. But we have an issue if only rich people can afford to buy food, don't we? So we have to have policies, therefore, that allow some sort of control. And I'm no economist, so I really can't answer your question very easily, okay? All I can do is try to make sure that we produce enough food for all of the people, in which case the demand of rich versus poor becomes less important. But then we have to have health policies for obesity. We have to have food distribution policies that are better than what we have now around the globe. When I was a young man, my father was a wheat grower, and we, Australia, were throwing wheat into the sea because the price of wheat was too low to sell. I can't imagine the stupidity behind that sort of idea, okay, of dumping food. But it was what was happening in those days. So clearly, we've got some better and more intelligent things to do at the top of the political scale. Okay, thank you, everybody.
Thanks for that.
That's all right.